turns out you'll see it. And what it does is it actually has about 28,000 different mating types, different sexes. So you think about that, you know, you're a spore and you've randomly landed somewhere, and another spore, the same species, has randomly landed there as well, and you start growing what we call hyphae. They find each other, and if you happen to be the same sex, it's kind of a bummer, because you can't, right? So there's less chance for possibility. And I think that's an incredible adaptation. They are also prolific sporulators, meaning that they produce an incredible amount of spores. This mushroom also has the widest range. I mean, nobody can say, you know, deterministically how, you know, which mushroom has the widest range, because we just haven't studied them enough. But this one has the widest range, as far as we know. It's on every continent except for Antarctica. And it has this incredible other adaptation where when it dries out, it shrivels up and shrinks. And then when it rains, that same mushroom that looks like that comes back out and can keep doing its thing. So I think that this kind of adaptability and that ability of just creating an enormous number of possibilities is a lesson that I take as a huge source of inspiration. Like when we started radical mycology, we had no idea where all of these ideas were going to go. We just wanted to do it. We just wanted to like grow mushrooms and teach people what we were learning and get excited and be enthusiastic and then see what happens, you know? And I have no idea what any of you are going to do with any of the things that I talk about and where that knowledge might go, but I want to just generate ideas, generate inspiration, and see where that takes us.
What is that one called?
It's called Schizophyllum commune, is the scientific name. It's also called the split gill fungus. So you can see the gills kind of have this little splitting. Yeah. So mycology is the study of fungi. Mycelium is the underground part of the organism. So if you think of a mushroom, it's like the fruit of a tree. It's just the sexual reproductive part of the organism. And the body of it is the mycelium that's underground. The thing that it's growing on is the substrate. So for most fungi, that's going to be some sort of dead plant material. But it can also be an animal. They can actually hunt nematodes, underground worms. They can grow on dead animals. They can grow on petroleum products of all different kinds, because those are a type of fermented dead plant. They can grow on all sorts of things, all sorts of different substrates. And spawn is just kind of mycelium with intention, as my friend Ray likes to call it. So it's mycelium that you have a plan for. And what's really cool about mycelium is that it breaks apart hydrocarbon rings. So you can see those up there. You see those little bonds connecting the C's and the H's. They have these extracellular enzymes that degrade those and can take a piece of wood and, using those enzymes and acids, turn it into soluble sugars and amino acids. And basically take that carbon that was in that form and make it available to others to be able to use. And they actually create their own types of little microbiomes. They have this ability of kind of facilitating groups of bacteria and other fungi that can work together and keep off competing microbes, which is pretty incredible. And then what they put out are different substances. So they're incredibly important in the process of decomposition. They're responsible for 90% of all decomposition that happens in the world. None of us would exist without them on so many different levels. In fact, humans actually, and animals came from fungi, and fungi are estimated to be about 2.5 billion years old. So some of the oldest and most ancient and most evolved species that we have in the world, I would say, are fungi. And from that came animals. And our cells, our bodies, our biology, is incredibly similar to the fungi. Fungi are not plants. Plants get their energy through photosynthesis, and fungi get their energy through decomposing carbon, which is what we're all doing when we're digesting our snacks. We just do it inside of our bodies, and fungi do it outside their bodies. Saprotrophic fungi are an incredibly crucial part of our ecosystem. And it's actually, there's a new study that came out that I'm trying to find it so I can cite it, so I'm sorry that I can't cite it. But it was saying that about 30% of the carbon in the soil is actually just mycelium. So not only would we not have carbon available or nutrients available for plants and other organisms to grow and live, but we wouldn't actually have any soil itself. We wouldn't have that. So that 30% of the carbon in the soil is the fungi itself, that organism, and it's holding onto it. So it's the biggest carbon sink that there is. And it's an incredibly crucial part of what holds back climate change, and I think what is protecting us from that. They also hold on to an incredible amount of water. So when a tree dies, it releases all of that water, and the fungi are what's making that water available to the ecosystem. And slowly, like hold on to it when it's dry. Like that split gill that we saw is kind of like a metaphor for what fungi do in the ecosystem in general. You know, it's dry, they hold on to it, and they shrink up and they hide the water, and then when the rain comes, it lets it out again. So that water is more evenly distributed over time and space. I want to talk about bioremediation. I think folks are probably fairly familiar with this concept. It's basically just the use of anything biological to degrade something that's toxic and make it less toxic. And I'm going to talk about just one component of what needs to be a whole ecosystem of remediation when there's a toxin. You know, people like to have this approach of like, okay, what can we pick apart? How can we find and isolate one piece that's going to come in and fix all our problems? When in fact, you need to take a much more holistic ecological approach and think about how everything's going to interact and think about beyond your own lifetime and the larger span of things, what's going to happen with whatever place, whatever habitat that you're in. So fungi are usually really good at coming in right after a disturbance. And like I said, they can break apart hydrocarbon molecules, which is what petrochemicals are all made out of. But just that on its own is only going to do so much. Bacteria can take care of a lot of things that are already partially decomposed and kind of continue and further that work. And bacteria, I'm not going to talk about it very much, but bacteria have an incredible potential for, and that's one of the projects, well, I will talk a little bit about it because our work in Ecuador is working with bacteria because we already know that they're capable of biodegrading petrochemicals, and bacteria can live underwater, which fungi cannot. All fungi are aerobic, meaning they need air to breathe like us. And then after the bacteria come in, it's nice to have plants. Plants are especially good at hyperaccumulating heavy metals and balancing the pH of the soil depending on what type of plant you're using. There's a whole world of phytoremediation out there, which is incredibly powerful. And then once those plants have grown up and died, though, you need to do something with them and then also return that carbon to the soil, which is where the fungi come in. So it's a cycle, right? So I'm going to talk a little bit about microremediation. Fungi can also hyperaccumulate heavy metals, meaning that the mycelium, that incredible network that lives underground, can uptake heavy metals such as mercury, cadmium, lead, and put them into their fruiting bodies, which is the mushroom. And then everybody, I'm sure, I'll just try to address this because this is what everybody asks every talk that I think has ever been given about hyperaccumulation of heavy metals is, what do you do with the mushrooms then? Was somebody thinking of that question? Yeah, somebody was about to ask that. And I don't have a good answer, I'm sorry. There is no good answer. Microfiltration is the use of mycelium as a biological filter to clean contaminated water. And this is, you know, like I said, they can't grow underwater, but they can grow with water. They need a lot of water to survive. So this is a project that Bay Area Radical Mycology, which is now called Bay Area Applied Mycology, a really fantastic group. So they did this really great project where they were, one of the things that you can do with fungi is the Stropharia mushroom, the King Stropharia, is really good at killing E. coli. And so you can water that's contaminated with E. coli, you can create this. Remember that picture of the mycelium? This stuff, it's an incredible network. It's a very thick web, and it's really good at capturing things and releasing those enzymes, and it can, it's always competing with bacteria and other decomposers, and it wants to like kind of have its own turf, right? As it's doing that, one of the things that it can kill is E. coli, which is pretty awesome. So these mycelial webs are super crucial for keeping soil together. Who was here last year when we had all of those mudslides all over the Bay Area? And a huge reason for those, the reason it got so bad, was because, you know, when the drought happened, and it's still happening, not when it happened, I'm sorry, as the drought happened, it dries out the mycelium. So those mycelial webs, you know, like I said, they're like a sponge, and they're really helping those plants hold on to the soil. But if they don't have water for long enough, they will die back. And so a lot of that mycelial web was just very shrunken and very impacted by the lack of water. And so then when the water comes, there's nothing to keep the soil from sliding right down. So a lot of people are, adding carbon and building these booms that have wood chips or straw in them, and some of them inoculated in order to hold onto the soil and keep it from eroding. And filtering contaminants at the same time as you're doing that, which is very cool. Yeah, we have a number of ecological issues here in California that I think can be addressed using some of these methods. And I know that, I can't really speak to it because I don't totally understand what they're doing, but I know that in Sonoma County there's been a huge micro-remediation effort. Yeah, I could talk about mycorrhizal fungi for a really long time because they're so incredible. So mycorrhizal fungi are fungi that build a relationship with the roots of a plant. So let's say, you know, you're that little pine seedling over there and your roots are actually not that helpful. We think the plant is getting most of their water and nutrients through their roots by themselves, but actually they're pretty incapable of doing much of any of it by themselves. And they need to have a fungus attached to their root system, which expands that network. And what it does is it helps them, it mines that water and mycelium for them. In exchange for glucose, sugar, which is what the plant makes out of sunlight. So it's a beautiful symbiotic relationship, and it's crucial. You know, 90% of all plants have a mycorrhizal partner. A lot of plants that live in very difficult environments, or in, you know, places like this, where it might be really dry or the soil might be really thin, that mycorrhizal fungi is especially important. And in terms of, I'm trying to bring this back to carbon and climate stuff because I think there's a strong interest for that in this room. People would estimate that 50 to 70% of the carbon in leaf litter and in soil is from mycorrhizal fungi. So think about that. That's a huge amount. They're, you know, what is literally holding onto the carbon in the soil and keeping it from going away and keeping the plants alive, which of course suck in the CO2. Arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi have a certain type of, you know, they're just called that because of a certain type of relationship, the way that they connect to the roots. And this is a type of mycorrhizal fungi that people are particularly interested in because of its role in sequestering carbon, reducing erosion, and helping plants survive, especially in agricultural zones. And it's one of the easier types of mycorrhizal fungi to work with. Its spores are actually so big that you can see them almost with the naked eye. They're like really tiny, but you can see them. They're easier to cultivate, and there's a protocol for how to cultivate them at the Rodale Institute. If you think about it, you know, some people talk about the Dust Bowl and how we are kind of heading towards another Dust Bowl, and the lack of soil is terrifying when that soil goes away. And a huge reason for that is when you plow a field, There used to be these prairies all over the Midwest and the Southwest. There are these huge prairies where buffalo would roam, and if you were to dig down in the soil, you'd find that it's like 2-3 feet thick, and that there's mycorrhizal fungi growing at the base of all of those grasses there. And then, when you plow it and you get rid of all of those mycorrhizal fungi, the soil just lifts up and takes off and blows away. So I think that's basically what happened with the buffalo. That's why that's the cause of it. So there are a lot of people getting really excited about growing mushrooms on cigarette butts, which I think is awesome. And I just wanted to kind of give a shout out to some of those folks. Peter McCoy helped develop a protocol for that. Alex Dorr has been developing a strain that's adapted to strain of oyster mushroom, again, that is especially adapted at degrading cigarette butts. And Danielle Stevenson up in Canada has been working with a city government and like growing mushrooms on large amounts of cigarette butts up there, which is really exciting. And I think that if you're going to do this work, you need to remain connected to any larger social issues that are happening in the communities that you're working in. That might be obvious to some people, maybe not, I don't know. So the work that I do with co-renewal, which is also often referred to as Amazon Micro-Renewal Project, which by the way is very difficult to translate into Spanish, so we're just going with co-renewal for now. And we're doing a lot more than just mushrooms too, so that's part of the reason for the name change. In the 60s, Chevron, or it was then Texaco, it's now owned by Chevron, did some incredibly disastrous forms of oil extraction. Oil extraction is never pretty. It always pollutes. It always causes problems. But this was particularly nasty and left what is arguably the largest land-based oil spill in the world. Nigeria will say that they have the largest one, which they very well may. I don't know. In any case, you know, we estimate about 18.5 billion gallons of toxic waste dumped in around people's houses, in people's waterways. So, you know, I don't think anybody here does all of their washing and bathing and laundry and drinking from the stream by their house, but people there do. That's like how they survive. And so, there's stories of kids going down to the river, three-year-olds, any age, going down and dying the next day, you know? They have the highest rates of deformities in Ecuador, they have the highest rates of cancer, they have the highest rates of asthma, they have a huge slew of health problems related to this pollution. And Chevron, or Texaco, I'm sorry, now owned by Chevron, actually had the technology to do things in a slightly less damaging, polluting way, and they didn't do it. And then they've refused to take any responsibility. So we have, you know, an incredible amount of documentation of these oil spills. You can go down there and meet up with one of our people who works with our organization named Donald Moncayo, and he'll show you all of these different oil spills. And Chevron just says that they're not theirs. And there's been a lawsuit that's been going on, I think 23 years now, against Chevron, and Chevron just refuses to take any responsibility. It's a group of about 30,000 people who are on this lawsuit in Ecuador against Chevron, they've actually won the case in multiple courts. They won it in Ecuador. The people of Ecuador won the case in Ecuador, and they're like, oh, well, we can't get a fair trial in Ecuador. So they moved to the United States, and they're like, oh, we can't get a fair trial in the United States because they lost there. And so they moved to Canada. And so now it's in Canada and they're losing there. And we're just going to have to wait and see what's happening. And then meanwhile, you know, it's like some of the highest paid lawyers in the world, these huge corporate lawyers against people who are just people who grew up with this pollution and want to see it cleaned up. And they want to see Chevron pay for that cleanup. So our role, we are a US-based nonprofit. We have allies and we work with communities in Ecuador, but we don't in any way pretend to represent them. And what we are trying to do is channel resources and technologies and methods that can be helpful. And we've allied with UDAPT and our hope. UDAPT is an organization that represents the people of Ecuador against Chevron and the legal case. So it's a group, it basically helps represent those 30,000 individuals who are suing Chevron. And they have a buyer mediation subcommittee, which we work with. And what our goal is basically is, you know, the oil spills need to be cleaned up no matter what. That's everybody's goal, is to clean it up. And if the money ever does come from Chevron, and if you ask them, it's not a matter if it's a win, because they've devoted their entire lives to this and it needs to happen. So when the money comes from Chevron, we want to know how to spend it, and we want to have that earmarked. So we're doing research, basically, to figure out what the most effective ecological methods are for cleaning up these oil spills. Can anybody tell what's happening in that picture there? Yeah, this is one of those nasty oil pits. This is a pit of where it's this sludge, you know, crude oil, has been sitting for 50 years, 50 plus years, and there's a log soaked in that petroleum, and this pycnoporus is growing right out of that log. We're very interested to know what is happening there. We don't know what's happening, but that is interesting, right? Mm-hmm. Given that similar types of fungi break down petroleum and other in North America, nearly all of the research on micro-remediation has all been in North America and Europe. And so we just don't know, you know, so people, when you were down there, it was mostly working with oysters, yeah? Mm-hmm. Which are not native to that region. And so while very effective, they're not as likely going to maybe be, they may be able to adapt and work at remedying some of this pollution, but it's also not going to be very sustainable and it might not be able to be applicable on a larger scale. So what we're doing is we're trying to conduct these fungal enzyme assays to get to know this mushroom and other mushrooms that are growing in the oil spills. There's only so much that you can tell from, you know, just seeing what's above ground, what's in the fruiting body. You really have to analyze the soil. And so what we're going to do, once we get funding, what we're going to do is test these different places where there's been oil contamination and see what types of fungi are growing there and what other kinds of microbes. We won't know, but the bacteria that are there as well. And get to know them. And you know, characterize and identify them, see what's growing there, and then see what enzymes they're producing, and get to know the genetics of those enzymes. And then from there, we know which fungi to culture and which ones can be most effective at cleaning up this pollution. So it's not coming in and like being, hey guys, we got the solution. It's like listening and testing and studying and getting to know it, and not just you know, one individual within that ecosystem, but how the whole ecosystem as a whole is functioning. How is micro-remediation, or how is the whole bioremediation process, you know, remember those three different components are a part of this whole cycle, right? How is that process already happening? And how can we enhance and support that process? And we have a mycological research station in Ecuador, which is a space, you know, once we know which fungi we want to work with, this is where we'll be able to grow them out of. This is Lexi, our program manager. She's teaching a lot of classes there. This one is with students at a local university. She also teaches classes to women's cooperative. And so she's just figuring out ways that mushrooms can be grown sustainably as a food source. She's growing it on, you know, she does a lot of her cultivation mostly on waste sugar cane. So it's like there's a sugar processing plant down the road from where she lives, and they have these giant piles of sugar cane. And so she gets their sugar cane and decomposes it and grows mushrooms out of it and feeds her family. And it's, you know, it's an open access community resource. Yeah, a lot of really cool research is starting to happen there, which is very exciting. And it's basically like on a shoestring of a shoestring of a shoestring budget. You might notice that theme is that all of our projects need money. This is actually one that doesn't have quite as desperate for money, because we partnered with a local municipality that's been funding a lot of the project. But So, I wish I had a nice aerial view picture, but this picture is cool because it shows you what's been built. Before we begin consulting and working with this community, it's a city, a small city in eastern Ecuador. All of the waste from the landfill, all of the leachate that was coming out of the landfill was going right into the water. And of course making people quite sick. Up here you can see the canal, it's like where everybody in the community goes to butcher their animals, so all of the animal waste is going right into the water. And all of the human sewage, a lot of it is going right into the water. This guy, Bob Rossin, who's with International Wastewater Solutions, and Lexi, and our folks down there, what we've been doing is they set up a series of biological filters for the different contaminants before it goes into the water. And using biochar, if folks are familiar with that, which in the Amazon rainforest I think is a lot more feasible and a lot more ecological than some of the ideas that people are doing using that technology other places. I don't know, biochar is a little bit controversial, but I think in this application it's very appropriate. So using bacteria and then also establishing recycling and composting and repurposing projects. And then also, teaching people about reduce, reuse, recycle and helping other people in other municipalities replicate this. So after this project happened, we got contacted by a few other municipalities and other places. People are very interested in doing similar projects at their own landfills. It's exciting. And we're developing, that is a thing that we need funding for, we're developing a manual that'll be both in English and Spanish that can be used for building and maintaining these kinds of systems. Okay, so our biggest project that we're focused on right now that we have I actually have to sign a PDF in the next couple of days to finalize our agreement with UDAT and with International Wastewater Solutions, or IOS is another name they go by, International Organic Solutions. So basically this guy, Bob Rossin here, he's been working with bacteria that grow in poop for a really, really long time. And he's developed this product called IOS 500 that works really well for cleaning contaminated soil and water, by the way, which is very cool because our fungi have a harder time with a lot of the water stuff. For decontaminating those areas. So this is some of the projects that we've done in other places, and we're like, okay, well, this stuff, which is I think where we need to go with the fungal research, this could take a long time before we have anything that can show tangible results and be applied, immediately. This is a product that already exists that's been shown to biodegrade petrochemicals in a variety of different environments around the world. We don't yet know whether it works within the Amazon environment. And that's why we're going to do this pilot project to test it and see if it works there.
What's his name?
Oh, Bob Rossin. And International Wastewater Solutions.
Did you?
Yeah. So this is a really cool project. We have basically all of our ducks in a row. We have the plans for it. We have the partnership. We're building relationships with pieces of land where we can do it. We have a team put together. We just need $65,000. So if anybody knows how to access that, please come talk to me. I've been trying for years to get funding for this project. And I think it's a really important project that needs to happen. And we've written a number of grants that we haven't gotten. If anybody has ideas for fundraising or wants to help us with our fundraising, that's really what we need. So I just wanted to put in a plug. The members of Core Renewal are all getting together in upstate New York in August, and we're going to be teaching a 4-day-long intensive about micro-remediation techniques. It's not an introductory level, so there's going to be, if you're not already experienced, or there's a required reading. But it's really for people who have ideas about micro-remediation and are excited about it, maybe have a little bit of experience, but like really want to like put their ideas into action, or really want to get involved and do something that's actually going to produce real results and generate real data and publish papers and things like that. So we're going to be getting together and talking about how we can put those ideas into action and going pretty deep into a lot of the science and some pretty cool cutting edge cultivation techniques as well. And also talking about the environmental justice component of doing bioremediation and how we can integrate that into our work and make it more holistic. And then it's going to be followed by, so this event is going to be about like 25, 30 people, like very focused, just one track at a time, you know, one class at a time. And it's going to be a larger, more conference style event that's going to be maybe 100 plus people. That's going to be the Friday, Saturday, and Sunday of that week. And that's going to involve a lot more environmental justice workshops and have people coming from more than just mycology backgrounds and all camping out and having fun. Do you see this little droplet? That's this enzyme that I was talking about, which are so incredibly powerful. So that's, you know, when you take a medicinal mushroom, it's those enzymes that they're producing that has those antimicrobial components that might help you, you know, fight off an illness. So mycelium has this incredible pattern. It might look familiar because it looks like our brain, it looks like the internet, it looks like decentralized social movements. It looks like rivers, veins on a tree, because this pattern here allows for more surface area to be exposed per unit of biomass. So they can spread very far and wide without using a whole lot of resources. So that, you know, let's say there's a little bit of water over here, but then there's a whole bunch of potassium over here, you can get that. And these strands, I mean, this is several strands woven together, actually, if you want to be able to see with the naked eye, because they're only one cell thick, so they're microscopic. And so they're growing under the ground all the time, these fungal filaments, mycelial network, constantly moving and exploring. And they do this incredible process where, as they're moving, they're feeling their environment, they explore, and it's like they analyze that information, and then they can figure out what enzymes they need to produce to eat that food source, that substrate. And it's like they dip into their genetic library in order to think and process, and then they can move forward. People have used that same process. This is a little tangential, but and what I hate it that it's called training fungi, because it's not actually training them. It's a very anthropocentric way of seeing it. Like, oh, we're going to train the fungi how to do this. But what you can do is, you know, you can take a novel contaminant, something that the mushroom has never seen before, and get some of this mycelium growing on the same petri dish. And the same process will happen as what happens in their environment, where they put out these fungal filaments. And actually, by the way, each one of the ends of these has several different genetic components. And those can stay connected and in touch with fungal filaments that may be like miles away even. So the incredible amount of ability to adapt genetically to what's happening is huge. So that contaminant and that mycelium on that dish, they will literally grow around, the mycelium will grow around it, feel it, get into it, maybe grow in it, maybe be hurt by it, come back, and then figure out what enzymes it needs to produce, and then be able to actually eat that contaminant. So that ability to adapt, to see like, okay, I'm not gonna get anything else to eat here, like, well, how can I figure out how to eat this? I think is really inspiring. And then also bringing resources where they're most most needed. I didn't really talk about this. One of the cool things about mycorrhizal fungi, which probably some of you, I'm sure a lot of you actually have heard about, is their ability to distribute resources where they're most needed within an ecosystem. And they act kind of as a balancing out force within that ecosystem. So let's say you have who's walked in a redwood forest? It's kind of dark in there, right? So imagine you're a little seedling trying to grow and get some sunlight. It can be quite difficult. And what the mycelium can do is, if they're connected to that young sapling, but they're also connected to what we call a mother tree, a much larger, more established tree, they can actually not only help that sapling get the nutrients and water like we talked about, that it would need to grow, but actually channel some sugar as well, so that sapling can continue to grow. And it's an investment, because when that tree gets tall enough, it's gonna be able to bring more sugar back. Right? So I think it's a good investment. They're literally, redistributing the water and nutrients where it's most needed within an ecosystem, even redistributing the sugar and the carbon as well, and helping the ecosystem as a whole become more powerful and robust through these networks. And I think that that's an important lesson. Our best survival strategy as a species, my belief, is not to be individualistic and not to just look out for ourselves. The best strategy for our own survival in the long term is going to be to support the whole ecosystem and to figure out how we can do that. So they can, travel huge areas in order to do that. The largest organism in the world is a large mat of the honey mushroom, the armillaria mushroom, which covers about 2,200 acres in eastern Oregon. And it's massive. It might be even bigger because it's, mycelial web. So how do you really know? And then I just added this thought. I'm just gonna do this. Has anybody read Emergent Strategy yet? Are you guys gonna read this book? I really like this book a whole lot. I really recommend it. It has a lot of stuff about biomimicry and mycelium. And it also talks a lot about how the focus is, for the mushroom, it's not about building biomass, it's about building relationships. It's not about, in our movements, I think a lot of our focus is on, how can we get big enough and loud enough that people will hear? How can we get strong enough and powerful enough? And I think refocusing on building relationships in the way that fungi and other organisms within the ecosystem do, and putting our energy into building those relationships, that's where our real resiliency and our real power lies. Yeah, I think that's enough.